Welcome everyone to this webinar hosted by Toradex entitled Achieving Exceptional Graphics for IoT Devices of Tomorrow with i.MX8 and Crank Software. We have with us today our guest and partner, Crank Software, who will be the main presenters today. So let me go ahead and introduce myself. I'm Jeremias Cordova. I'm an embedded systems engineer at Toradex. And on the Crank side, we have Scott Snyder, product marketing manager at Crank, as well as Nick Schultz, an FAE at Crank. Before diving into the webinar, let me cover a few organizational points. Please use the chat window of the webinar tool if you have any technical issues and wish to let us know. The team will try and resolve any of these issues promptly. At the end, we will also do an interactive question answer session. You can type your questions in the chat window at any time, and we'll go ahead and try to pick them all up at the end if time permits. Finally, this webinar is being recorded and will be made available for on-demand viewing within about a week from today. With all of that settled, let's go ahead and get started. First of all, I'll begin with a brief overview of who Toradex is and what it is we do for those who don't know. Toradex, as a company, focuses on making embedded computing easy to use so you can get simple access to the latest technology for your product development. We achieve this by providing highly reliable ARM-based system on modules, or SOMs for short. Our products also include software and technical support. Here at Toradex, we strive to offer the lowest cost of ownership to you, and this means not just the module price, as we also consider things like your development effort, time to market, and long-term maintenance of your product. We are proud of being able to have industry-leading support, including a very active community forum and a developer site with over 800 informational and technical articles, which are updated daily. As you can see by the graphic here on this slide, we have offices all around the world, meaning you get local support and shipping based on your location. Now, really quick, I'd like to just go ahead and explain our focus markets here at Toradex, since these are markets which we kind of optimize and tailor our products towards. As you can see here, we have industrial automation, healthcare, transportation, test and measurement, and finally, smart city. Of course, outside of these key markets, we still provide service to a broad range of industries and products. Typical projects that we participate in have volume requirements of a few hundreds to a few 10,000s of products annually. With all of this, Toradex currently has thousands of active customers around the world. Now here we have a short overview of our products here at Toradex. As you can see, we have three SOM families. Within each of these families, the modules are pin compatible. So you can seamlessly scale from say an i.MX6 to an i.MX7 to an i.MX8 as long as it's all within the same family. Here in the middle, we have our cost and power efficient Calibri family. At the top, we have the higher end Apollos family. And finally, and more recently at the bottom, you can see our new Verdin family, which will make an appearance later in the webinar. Over here on the right on the slide, you can also see the production quality software that is provided with these modules out of the box. Speaking of software, apart from highly reliable system on modules, Toradex also provides production ready software, as well as reference images for the Octo project, which we use to build all our Linux-based offerings. Toradex is also active in mainlining its code for its system on modules for the benefit of the community at large. Here on the slide, you can see we're highlighting a particular software offering, Horizon, which is our brand new free and open source software offering from Toradex. In short, Horizon is an easy to use industrial Linux platform. As with our overall goal as a company, it focuses on lowering your time to market and can be used out of the box with our hardware. Being based on open source means you have, of course, no lock-in, and you can adjust any component of Horizon to fit your particular needs or project requirements. Horizon comes with an automotive grade update client to allow for simple, safe, and secure software updates. Security is another focus of Torizon with these frequent updates and simple access to hardware security features that make it easy for you to develop a securable device. There's also a real-time option available. And in Toradex, we also utilize modern continuous integration and verification processes. This means that by the time Torizon release gets to you, it is stable and well-tested. Finally, Torizon utilizes Docker for software containerization. If you don't know what Docker or containerization means, just know that it allows for a vast, easy-to-install software ecosystem, such as Crank Solution, which we'll now be moving on to.
Thanks, Jeremias. Hello, everybody. I am Scott. I'm just going to kind of give you a brief overview of who Crank Software is and introduce you to Storyboard, our GUI development tool, before I hand things off to Nick. So definitely when it comes down to it, developing products and, you know, if you want to get more specific, developing UIs for today's embedded products, you know, really has become, you know, more increasingly challenging because definitely when it comes down to it, user expectations have been elevated. So today's consumers expect an intuitive and modern touch experience. So not only for the physical hardware, but the quality and the overall smoothness or the smoothness of the experience of its graphical user interface. And it has everything to do with the fact that we all have this powerful device that's in our pockets or our purses that provides us that type of experience and has become the de facto that everybody kind of compares any type of product with a touchscreen against. So definitely when it comes down to it, this user experience has really quickly become, you know, a defining part of today's products, with the UI being one of the main factors that products are being measured on, and what often drives the value consumers see in the product and also drives their purchasing decisions. So the other thing that challenges is basically integrating evolutions and technology doesn't only mean making hardware decisions anymore and how they kind of come into play, but it's also how can you incorporate that into the product's user interface? And definitely, you know, when it comes down to it, any time lost or any time resources are wasted or any time coding changes need to occur, this can all create delays. And delays in getting the product to market on time and in some cases on budget. And that's where Storyboard comes in. So the founders of Crank Software set out to build a solution that could help remove the inefficiencies that frustrated them and their developer colleagues when it came to developing UIs for embedded products. So based on over two decades of experience in designing and implementing embedded GUI solutions for a broad range of industries, Storyboard was designed to really kind of break down the barriers, remove those issues that were typically associated with UI design and development. And so just in case this is maybe the first time you've ever heard of Crank Software or even Storyboard, you know, I can guarantee you that at some point in time, either maybe you yourself or the customers that you're building your products for have actually interacted with a product that's running a Crank developed UI using our Storyboard tool. Because as you can see, we support many different verticals, from medical to smart homes, and a lot of like Fortune 100 companies have come to us to either utilize our software directly or actually utilize ourselves to basically build that UI for them. And that's because not only is Crank a software company, but we're also a services company too. So we have a team of application developers that can, build the UI for a company if they don't have the in-house experience, or maybe they don't have the bandwidth because they have too many products that are being developed. So we have services that can really help them. So Crank Software was, like I said, built with over 20 years plus experience with the founders. Our leadership team has an extensive background in embedded graphics and systems. We have a large global footprint, like I said, from Fortune 500 to small organizations, and millions of devices that are out there in the field that are running a Storyboard built UI. The other thing to help you out too is that we do have a large global distribution partnership network for really allowing for localized support outside of North America or the UK. So that definitely means that it doesn't matter where you're located, or maybe your corporate headquarters is located, there's a way that we can interact and work with you to really make it easier for yourself. Plus, we have a large extensive partnership, including with, you know, the main silicon vendors like NXP and ST, and some vendors like Toradex. So how can Storyboard help you? Well, powerfully simple yet sophisticated is what we often hear our customers tell us. It's easy to use interface, really enables them to create UIs quicker and more efficiently. So this is all done because we decoupled the front end UI design from the back end logic. So enabling a designer and a developer to work in this collaborative parallel workflow when building the user interface. So really, Storyboard makes it easy for them to get started early on the UI. Really, it makes it easy to embrace design changes that occur and helps reduce the complexity of developing solutions or products for an ever-evolving embedded hardware or even maybe product lines that they may have. And so how is this all done? Well, definitely when it comes to accelerating development, the UI development can begin within familiar UI design tools such as Photoshop or Sketch. And then once they've kind of reached a state of completion, they can be easily imported into Storyboard, really creating the building blocks of the UI. And then from there, the UIs can be brought to life using Storyboard's integrated animation tools, allowing you to create and edit and review animations all directly within the tool itself. And of course, critical UI flow and usability testing can all be performed within Storyboard using its in-tool prototype and simulation functionality. And then from there, really helps you embrace iterations because as we know, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when design changes are going to occur, because, you know, once you kind of go and you present it to, maybe it's a focus group, or maybe it's your boss, or maybe it's a project, a larger project team, everybody has impressions and ideas as to maybe that button should be a little bit bigger, maybe it should be smaller, maybe it should be blue instead of purple, whatever it may be. So definitely it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when are those design changes going to occur. And so the beautiful thing about that parallel workflow is that it really helps remove the pain and the struggle associated with iterations that occur within embedded projects. So it allows you to really introduce design changes without impacting the progress or really causing a complete teardown of code to occur. So the designer or even the developer using the tool can really completely modify the UI look within the design tool, and then simply re-import, say, the Photoshop PSD file into Storyboard, allowing you to create an entirely new application or overwriting prior code development. So we have this unique aspect called graphical compare and merge, which really allows you to remain in the driver's seat to go through and see what those changes are, and you can simply pick and choose, or you can simply accept all and have those changes applied. And then from there, Storyboard really provides, you know, we used to always talk about scalability, but it's more UI flexibility, because with Storyboard being a platform agnostic tool, it allows our customers to really de-risk their projects by introducing this framework that easily supports technology and design changes to occur at any point in the development cycle. So allowing that UI kind of to kind of move along with it. So whether it's scalability, because maybe you're scaling down from an MCU up to a more powerful MPU, or maybe it's vice versa, or portability. So maybe it's you want to switch out parts of your technology stack, whether it's the hardware or the software as needed to take advantage of maybe new innovations or the introduction of new boards like the Verdin. So allowing you to kind of move that UI over to that new board. And then of course you have reusability, which allows you to take that UI that was created and use it across different board types, or whether it's MCU and MPU, or even completely different board types. And maybe it's the Verdin versus the Apollos. So allowing you to have a different range of product lines, but still providing that consistent brand experience for your customers. So really, what makes Storyboard different? Well, Storyboard, you know, it provides the foundation for this streamlined UI development with that collaborative parallel workflow. But more importantly is that we are not a code generation framework, which means that, you know, you can go in and there is Lua scripting that it uses, and Nick will cover that in a moment, and some C callbacks, but we're not a coding framework, which means it lowers the barrier for entry, because now, you know, you can have designers working on that front end while you focus maybe as a developer on the back end and connecting the two together with this well kind of defined data model and events API in between. But really what allows you is it's not relying on the coding changes or the hardware decisions to be made before the UI can begin. So you can easily start that UI design to keep yourself on track or ahead of the game. And that's actually one of the things that a lot of our customers love about it, is that they're able to short circuit the entire project cycle and get to market quicker, which then of course makes the company that much happier as well. And of course, because, you know, we have unique features like Storyboard's graphical compare and merge, really allows your teams to remain in control of those UI refinements. And of course, we've done all the extensive kind of back-end work for you of optimizing the engine to really take advantage of specific board features, whether it's proprietary graphic libraries, or maybe it's 2D or 3D hardware acceleration, and of course, memory management functions. So really kind of removing the hard work for you, allowing you to focus on what you do best. And so with that being said, I'm going to pass things over to Nick, who is going to take things over and actually provide you with a demo.
Hello, everybody, and big thanks for the introduction from Scott and Jeremias there. Thanks so much, guys. So as I said, my name is Nick Schultz. I'm the field application engineer over here at Crank Software, and I'm going to walk you through how we can go about creating some awesome graphics on your IoT devices leveraging the hardware and software platform from Toradex. So before we get going, I'll quickly show you what we're going to be working with today. I've got a Verdin platform with me, and I'll just move the webcam there. So as you guys can see, we've got the Verdin developer board with the i.MX 8M mini system on module. And it is running their Torizon platform with their container environment. So the Portainer app is running there. Apologize about the lighting and webcam there. Hopefully you can see it. And we're going to be leveraging this to rapidly deploy and create an awesome application. So if any of you have seen some of the webinars we've done in the past, you may be familiar with our flow, where we can take a application that was designed in Photoshop or another design tool, import it into our environment, rapidly build it up, add animations and other behaviors. And, you know, we're going to take a little bit of a different path today, because, you know, we've shown that workflow, and now we kind of want to expand upon that and show you what it's like in the deployment environment and how you can start, you know, connecting your device and getting it ready for the real world. So I'm going to start with a pre-existing app that I have open here. So this thermostat demo application, and I'll just simulate it right here for you so you can see. And you've probably seen it in some of our examples before, perhaps another webinar or other sessions, but we've got sort of a multi-function application. We've got you know, thermostat screen, heating and cooling with some nice animations here. So you can see here when I hit the plus or the minus, I've got that sort of color for the temperature and the increase to the value here. We've also got a weather screen, as well as a you know, a setting screen where we can go through, toggle some switches, go to some different screens, language internationalization, stuff like that. And, you know, the purpose of this is to show you what you might be working with, you know. So you're building up an application, and, you're running through and actively developing it. So by no means is this, you know, fully complete or completely functional or ready for production, but it's at the point where, you know, we've gotten some behaviors, and, you know, we really want to test it out and see what it's like on the hardware platform. So in this case, you know, I mentioned we have the i.MX 8M Mini, and it's running there Toradex's Torizon platform, and that's a Linux-based system with containers sort of baked right into it. And, you know, that's something that, you know, if you're familiar with Docker, they're one of the largest sort of container platforms out there on the market. But basically it allows you to encapsulate, you know, your application in a isolated environment, as well as it allows you to control all the dependencies in the deployment model. So basically you'll define a recipe for this container, you'll build it, and then, you know, you'll run and execute these bundles on your system. And, you know, it kind of gives you a nice isolation and an architecture. So from a deployment and development story, there's a lot of advantages to it. In, you know, the embedded world, this is something that's fairly new. It's been around in sort of the web and server world for a little bit. But, you know, as we're starting to bridge into the rich IoT devices that are being deployed on the market, this is starting to make sense. So our application here, our home control system, makes sense that, you know, it would run on one of these devices, but you might want to encapsulate it and then communicate to it from other places. So, you know, the first thing that we've done here is obviously I've got the ability to control temperature, but on the weather screen, you know, I've hooked up some events that we can send in with our event injection tools. So if we quickly look at our event model here, you can see I've got this weather update event. It's got values for the current temperature and the high and the low for the day with some guidelines here. And if we're playing around in our desktop environment, I'm going to make sure this is on top. You can see here that if I jump to our connector tab, I can inject these values. So let me just make sure we're at local there. If I drag this value over here, you can see I'm updating the values in the application. And this is awesome. This is kind of exactly what we want. It uses our I/O library called Storyboard I/O. But, you know, once it's in the containerized world, we have to find another way to communicate to it. So one of the nice features that we have in Storyboard 6.2 is the ability to reflect these events over TCP socket connections. And, you know, that plays perfectly into the containerized world where, you know, our application will be running in isolation, and, you know, we can expose a network endpoint and then inject those events that way. You know, and this perfectly mirrors how the application would work in production, where, you know, it's running in isolation, it will receive events, it doesn't know where the events are coming from, but it reacts to them and displays the data to the UI. So we'll close this up here, quickly jump over to our terminal. So we here have a SSH connection to the Verdin platform here. And what we have is, you know, the pretty standard install of Torizon from Toradex on their Easy Installer with a few modifications to it. One being I've created a container for us to run our Storyboard application, and it's based on top of the standard Crank partner containers that we offer. So if you're curious about that, you know, we've already done a webinar discussing that process. However, you can go to our website or Toradex's. So Crank software under our help center, we have a guide for running Storyboard in a Torizon container. So you can walk through the steps of getting your board up and ready. You can see the dependencies that are required. And the Toradex website as well has documentation here. So again, depending on where you are, if you're setting up your hardware and configuring that, there's more information on Toradex's side for making sure your displays and touch panels are working and configured correctly. But what that means is, in the world of the container, when we're on our platform, we run the docker ps command, you can see we are executing a few containers at the moment. You know, the webcam showed you the bright white portainer IO screen, and you can see those containers listed here after we ran docker ps. But we also have this Debian container that has the Weston interface to it. And this is something that is a dependency to run the Storyboard application. So we need to be able to interface with the Weston client. So this container exposes and provides that functionality. So that is something that's going to be there. We've got it configured to auto boot and run. And for now, we're just going to go off and stop the Toradex container. So you can use the docker stop command, pass in the names of the containers, and then do the same thing for the other one. And this is where I'll just flip the webcam on over there so you can see what's going on here. Disable the kiosk. There we go. So we've slayed that off. You can see here on the webcam, now we've got that blank screen hooked up to the display. So back over to our container. The first thing that we need to do is, I'm just going to quickly tell you a little bit about what's required to run, but the container image that we've got is, as I mentioned, based off of the ones described on the website, and you can go through and build your own if you'd like, or we'll have some information on our website about how to construct your own container based off of what we've done. But basically what happens is there is our Storyboard engine runtime that's deployed onto the system inside the container. There is a script which basically sets up the environment variables required to execute Storyboard. And then finally there is a command that executes and launches the Storyboard instance when the container starts up. And the other aspect that we're going to do is, while you're launching the application, there's going to be some configurations passed in. One, to expose a network port, basically saying, hey, we want to expose a certain port to the host platform, as well as, we want to map it to an internal port within the container. So that's how we can bridge the networking of the two worlds there. And then also we're going to map in a shared directory. And this shared directory is going to be under crank scp. And right now that's empty, but that's where we're going to deploy our new application. So I've done a lot of talking here. First thing that we're going to do is we're going to run our container. And actually, one thing I forgot to mention is there's also a pre-deployed application inside of it, just in case you're not ready to start deploying your own apps, you can at least test things out and run them. So you see we have our run command, our port mapping, so we're mapping port 55,555, same thing on the inside of the container, and this is where we're mapping our crank SCP directory inside the container space under user crank SCP. When we run it, also the name I gave it, so nick crank, crank horizon, and then a storyboard TCP tag. So when we run it, you can see we've got some output, we've got some diagnostic messages for some network binding, and those are basically just parameters for the sockets about how it recycles its ports. Nothing crazy here since we're just doing some development. But if we go back, you can see we have our application running. And if I interact with it, touch is working. We've got nice patient vital screens nice 3D model I can spin around here, different views of it. You see a skeleton, and you know, you can inspect what's going on with the patient there. So that's a pretty cool demo. It's also something that gives you a really good idea of what the you know, the hardware and software combination is capable of. And you know, from there, if we're, you know, it helps us evaluate, we can then start dropping everything on. So I'll close that down there. Nice convenient close button on the top. So as I said, the container runs and it executes and launches a pre-deployed application, but now we can take our app and deploy it over SCP. So if we go back to our storyboard design environment, go into my storyboard export configurations, I can then walk through and decide, okay, what do I want to do? Do I want to export the entire app, build up the you know, the content, drop it in piecemeal, and then once it's exported, where do I want to put it? By default, we would simply export the model file to the file system, so the same directory as our project, but in this case, we're going to select SCP. You know, I've already got some of the presets existing here, so you know, we're going to deploy our application under Home to Rise and Crank SCP, the IP address, so we can connect to the device over the network, the username and password, to Ryzen and root in this case, since the default passwords on the to Ryzen containers, I believe, are to Ryzen, but they prompt you to change it. So I, you know, took the option of doing the ever secure option of using root here. But once we have all that set up, we can run, and it'll deploy all the content in our application. And what that looks like in the project, you can see here, you know, and we've got the export dialog saying that SCP was completed successfully, but basically it includes our images, our scripts, fonts, any of the assets required to run our application based on what we saw when I simulated it. So now that it's been deployed, this is where we can jump back to our terminal environment, and if we list the contents of Crank SCP again, you can see now we've got you know, the gap file, this is the generated model file from the export, scripts, images, all of that content there, which is super awesome. So all we need to do now is run our container, and the container is going to be checking in this directory, which is mapped, again, as I mentioned earlier, under user Crank SCP, for any gap files, and if it finds it, it'll run and execute that. Otherwise, it'll use the medical app that we showed earlier. So we're going to launch our application. Again, we see similar the socket message here, but if we show our webcam, now we have our nice application. I've got my animations, as we saw earlier. You know, our nice little pull-out menu there where I can navigate between different screens. We've got our weather application, and if I minimize this, keep this on top, you can see here I could actually reflect my events that I've defined over the TCP connection that we've exposed. So using the remote channel, passing in the IP address, and the port value there. So using that, I can inject that information, and you can see in the application we are sending these events remotely, which is pretty awesome. Definitely helps from the deployment and development and rapid iteration story, where you can just feed your data in, and again, based on the nature of Storyboard and how it's event driven, this perfectly mirrors how you might be getting other events from other sources, whether they be other containers running in parallel or even network services or things like that. So we've got that working, and we can play around a little bit more. And if we start poking through the settings screens, you know, again, we've got our toggles here that are pretty cool. Go through here and our internationalization. So again, you can see now we're in German, and back to English, and we got our nice slider. And It's funny because dragging this around doesn't actually feel all that smooth. And this is where, you know, it doesn't seem like it would be a crazy thing to do, but you want to understand what's going on here. So, you know, the next step of this is, you know, how do we get diagnostic information off of our device? And to do that, you know, similar to how we've injected our data, we can actually inject some events to start toggling our metrics and take some performance logs. So instead of, you know, doing what we used to do where we would run the application pre-configured to start taking metrics, then, you know, stop it and SCP the log over, we can now toggle that on the fly. Since, you know, it might be a few different screens or perhaps a unique series of events that might trigger some behavior that you want to investigate. So now, you know, we can pick and choose when we start logging that data, so we can get a much more targeted snapshot. So what that looks like, if we jump back to the connector tab here, is we've got this icons in the top, start performance logging, stop performance logging, and configure the logging. And in this case, under configurations, this is where you can put your information in. So the name of the log that you want to generate, as well as a location and path. So in this case, user crank SCP, I'm going to call it output.log. So the log extension is basically our extension to tell the design environment how to interpret the data. You could call it anything else that you'd like, but then just, you know, make sure you give it that .plog extension, so when you look at it and inspect it, it gives you all the data. So I'm happy with that. I'm going to start logging. So we're running and logging our application there, and now I'm just going to go back and I'm going to drag this thing, and you can see it's, I apologize on the finger there, but you can see it's lagging behind a little bit. So if we do that a few times, and you know, we're fairly happy with what we've got, I can actually, you know, stop the logging now. So again, stop the performance log. And if we jump into our container, kill off the container here, and under crank SCP, we now have our nice output.plog, and I can grab this and inspect it in my desktop. So jumping into SCP there, and just for convenience, export the path. And this is where, you know, depending on the system you're on, I'm on a Linux system here, so it's easy to use some of the commands from the terminal. You could also use an FTP or SCP graphical client, I believe FileZilla, or there's some other options that'll allow you to do that. But I'm just going to transfer this log off of my host machine onto my desktop machine. So if I use the SCP command, the name, so the username of the container, Ryzen, and again at the IP address, 192.168.1.109. Put our path in there, and this is where it's called output.plog, and then I'll export it to my desktop. Put in the password, so you can see now we've output the file. So the final step now is to import that. So file, open. On my desktop here, I can select the file, and now that we have that here, we can actually start to inspect and see what's going on. You know, because we enabled some of the performance metrics, we also get some insight into the CPU usage, which seems pretty good. So it looks like it's not necessarily a throughput bottleneck that's slowing our slider down, but you know, we can start digging through here and see what's going on. And, you know, there's different options here. So if you were doing some development with a UI that was dynamically creating and deleting a lot of information, you'd get some information here, as well as event queues and timers and things like that. We also have a really nice new graphing feature, which starts to give you a visual output of what's happening on your system. And, you know, because I just sort of did a snapshot over time, you know, there's not a huge amount of information here. Whoops. But, you know, you can start to see, okay, like, what's our memory usage looking like? So you can see there was some usage climbing. We also have some CPU percentage, as well as milliseconds for redraw time metrics there. And right now, we're not so much concerned about the memory, so I can sort of disable some of the plots here. I think we're more concerned about CPU and redraw. And what we're seeing as we're walking through here, and this is, you know, based on screen, so it's on the settings screen, but had we been running the entire time, you'd see breakdowns of our weather screen, our settings screen, our thermostat screen. But we've got some spikes. And right here, you know, you can see we've got some events, and if you were to just sort of highlight, we've got spikes there, and another one there. So we want to kind of draw into that and understand what's going on. So, you know, there's a couple different ways you can do that, but if I hover over this point here, you can see that we've got some redraw happening on the settings screen. You can see the time it took, at what time and how long. So again, you know, 7 milliseconds, it's a little bit higher. Not egregious, but you know, you can start to get an idea and finger in the wind as to what's happening on your system. Same thing with our CPU usage. And, you know, in this case, we've got another one where we've got kind of 12 milliseconds at certain intervals, or sorry, 12% usage. So again, we can start poking through there. And you can define your own custom plots. You know, there's some pre-existing, pre-created ones, so there's a lot of depth that you can gain from this. But, you know, I just kind of wanted to showcase that this was here. And, you know, it gives you a lot of insight, and you can use that to drive back down into the logs. So in our case, you know, right now we've got a condensed log that as I expand it, you're going to start seeing more information. And this is instrumentation into the engine to just say, okay, what's taking time, whether it's, you know, events, processing, redraw, waiting on other systems, stuff like that. So, you know, as we drive through here, you can start to see we've got some blips. And they seem to be happening around the motion event, which is interesting enough. And that sort of matches up to what I saw where when I pressed and dragged the slider, it was lagging behind a little bit. And you can see our duration is 115 milliseconds, which if you're trying to hit a 60 frames a second, that's, you know, you're blowing your limit by a significant amount. You know, we really want things under 16 milliseconds if we're going to hit that smooth 60 frames a second metric. And the nice thing about this is I can actually dive down a little bit deeper and see what's going on here. So we see, you know, this motion event, and it's bound to a Lua action. And if I dig a little bit deeper, you can see the name of the function, CB slider motion. Okay, so it looks like we've got something going on in our Lua function here. And, you know, the quickest way to check that out is jump into our application. You can see we've got a couple different Lua files here, but the slider callback, find CV slider press motion. Here we go. And, you know, we're going through and all of a sudden, you know, we see this expensive calculation function call here. Seems a little bit suspect given the name and probably not something you'd want to do during a motion event. You know, these are things that are coming in very, very quickly. And, you know, if I look at that function, you know, this is obviously not something you'd want. So I stuck this in just for illustrative purposes, but, you know, it's not uncommon that depending on what you're doing, you might be doing calculations or logic in script that you might want to defer to another point in time or handle in a different process. So, you know, in this case, you know, we've created this sort of fictional issue here, but, you know, we're calling sleep for 0.1 seconds on the system, right? So, you know, that's a significant amount of time and matched directly to what we saw where we have these 115 milliseconds delays in terms of the Lua block. So, you know, the first thing I'll do is I'll delete this call, and we'll pretend that this is something that was just put in there for testing and debug purposes, because I'm sure no one would actually do that in a production application. So we've cleaned that up, and if we were to just, you know, quickly test here, go over to our settings screen, you can see now that seems a lot smoother. And the final step here would simply be to validate this on the embedded system. So we've already done all the configurations, so I can simply click my Storyboard application export. It'll deploy based on the last configuration we used. And if I jump back to the terminal, and open up my webcam there, this is where we can launch our container again. And you can see here we've got our nice thermostat screen. Everything's working the same way. We jump into settings, and we have our little slider here. It's much snappier, and that's, you know, exactly what we wanted, but that was there to illustrate the nice behavior that you can get, as well as, you know, how you can start debugging and seeing what's going on your running application in real time, all within the Toradex Torizon container. So thank you very much for your time. I hope you found this interesting, and I'm going to pass this back over to Scott and Jeremias, and I think close this off and then get ready for some questions. So thank you again for your time, and I really enjoyed showing this to you today.
Perfect. Thanks, Nick. Let me just go back. Hopefully everybody's seeing my key takeaways. So just to kind of wrap up things with Nick, definitely what he showed you was a fantastic kind of demo of Storyboard, highlighting some of the new capabilities that we just introduced within our last release. So some of the key things I just kind of want you to remember, we do have a free trial of Storyboard. So definitely if you're in the evaluation phase and you're looking to, you know, kick the tires on a new product, but more importantly, are looking to kind of, you know, kick the tires on a new GUI development tool, we do have that free trial software that you can get access to from our website. And we do, within our help center, have a variety of onboarding tools and papers, as well as getting started video tutorials to really kind of get you going. As Nick said, we do have a variety of sample GUI images that are there for you to basically download and really kind of evaluate the power and the graphical performance of the Verdin board or other SOMs that Toradex has to offer. And of course, at any point in time, if you need some assistance, have some questions, feel free to reach out to us to talk to our internal teams, whether it's our teams of support experts or our field application engineers. We can all be reached at sales@cranksoftware.com. And so with that being said, I'm going to pass things back over to Jeremiah, and he can take it from there.
All right, everyone, we've come to the end of the webinar now, so we'll go ahead and start our Q&A session. So anybody has asked their questions yet, feel free to go ahead and use the webinar tool to go ahead and type in your questions while we go through the questions that have been asked throughout the webinar. All right, then. First question we have here, I believe this is towards you, Nick. Can we have access to the source code of this application? I assume they mean the source code from the demo you showed off.
Yes, certainly. So I can help provide the recipe used for the Docker container. It's based off of the ones we use and provide sort of as examples. So there really isn't all that much of a change there. And then in terms of samples, so building up a storyboard application and getting it running on there. We've got lots of information on our website about how to do that, as well as, you know, sort of more fully fleshed out ones if you aren't looking to build it up yourself. So any requests for that or clarification, by all means, send them off to one of our contact information or support@cranksoftware.com or sales@cranksoftware.com, and we'll be happy to help you out.
All right, thank you, Nick. And see, the next question, still believe it's towards you, Nick, is will this application work with normal displays or not touchscreens? I guess, how would the demo application work with touchscreens if you were to make it for that?
Yeah, absolutely. So the nice thing about how Storyboard handles input, whether it be from a touch panel or from hardware devices, is that we receive and handle things as sort of genericized events. So whether it's coming from a touch panel or from a series of membrane switches or rotary controls, you can map those inputs into the application. And if you're not using touch, then we also have hooks around gaining and focus for controls. So you can, you know, have highlights pop up over buttons as you're navigating through and interface with them that way. And since you're on a Linux system, then, or well, in this case, a Linux containerized system, you can, you know, handle your mapping to the device hardware either directly or through, other external applications and C code and inject them into the engine.
All right, thank you again. See, this next question, is it possible to get for Crank and Toradex to do something for people who are switching from Microsoft environments to Linux? Yes, so I guess the question would be the kind of transition experience for people coming from, say, WinC to Linux, if there's something Crank and Toradex could do to kind of ease that transition.
Sure, and I'm sure this is probably a two-part answer between the Crank side and the Toradex side, but I'll jump in now. The one nice thing is that our software runs on a variety of embedded platforms. So today you saw, the Torizon embedded Linux platform, but Toradex also supports WinCE. So at least from a application development standpoint, you can build apps that work in both cases. And the migration side of it is simply deploying a new runtime engine built for the board, so your Storyboard application can run. So you don't have to change anything in your design or development environment. Now, from the porting of code and underlying backend systems, that's where we're always happy to provide guidance as to how you can import our I/O libraries to inject events into the running application, as well as that's probably where I can this with Jeremiah's from the Toradex side, and they have tooling and other solutions where they support both platforms, so I'm sure they have some guidance as well.
Yeah, and just to add from the Toradex perspective there, with Torizon we have added, tried our best at Toradex to kind of provide a easier transition path for people coming from Windows or WinCE based platforms. As Nick said, we do have various tools such as our IDE extensions on both Visual Studio Code and Visual Studio, which will help to kind of provide a simpler development environment for Windows users who are kind of used to that, those types of IDE environments for kind of just the more application based development. And for UI, you can, of course, use stuff like Crank Storyboard solution. All right, so this next question, does this IDE, I assume they're referring to the Crank IDE, support development to low level peripherals like UART, I2C, et cetera?
Sure, and the easy answer is yes. The more detailed answer is that we provide a tooling solution for the graphics layer, and that that executes and runs as its own process, And then we provide an interface library, which is called Storyboard.io, and it's a C library that allows you to then interface with any other system, whether it be another process, a hardware device, and inject events into the UI. And that is our general solution as to how you might want to, you know, read from an I2C device, or perhaps you know, some other sensors you may have hooked up. And you know, there are other modules that you could include into the you know, into the Lua environment, where you can compile your own modules and build them and access them there as well. So we give you a flexible choice as to how you want to do that. But many of our customers with shipping additional product, you know, think of a medical device, for example, will be reading from plenty of sensors and devices and integrating that feed into the UI.
All right, sounds good. Let's see, another quick question. Will this application, I assume the demo application, also work on an Apollos board?
Absolutely. The nice benefit of working with, you know, Toradex is that they've got, you know, great support for their software stack across the wide variety of devices they support. So specifically, you saw the Verdin SOM today, which was an i.MX 8M Mini. The Apollos line supports i.MX 6s, i.MX 8s, you know, in the quads or other low-end ones. And you can swap out the SOMs or switch to a different carrier board, and then also deploy the containers there as well. You know, if you're sticking in the i.MX 8 line, say you're going from the Mini, which I showed you today, to the Quad Max on the Apollos, then the same container will drop in and run. If you're switching to an i.MX 6, then there's simply a modification of the executable, and that's simply just due to the different CPU architecture. But you know, you don't have to do anything major. You know, it's pretty much drop in and go.
Okay. Let's see. You mentioned needing Weston for Storyboard. Was that on the dev host or the target? If the target, can it run on EGL as well?
Yes. So the Weston interface on the development machine, so the Verdin, that's simply that's running on top of the OpenGL hardware there, and you know, in that case the container exposes an interface for us to create a window and draw to. There are other configurations you can run without Weston, so think of a direct frame buffer OpenGL access. Or you could also use software rendering versions as well. So, you know, things through DRM and the i.MX 6, the frame buffer devices. So, you know, we want to support all the different options possible, since not all platforms in the embedded space have accelerated graphics. But when there is hardware available, we want to support that as well to help you gain the best performance possible.
Let's see. All right. And can Storyboard run on MCUs where you may not have separate processors or dedicated processors?
You certainly can. So a good example is a joint partner between Toradex and ours is NXP, and they've got a line of MCUs called the VRT series, and they're usually running an RT or a real-time executive like FreeRTOS, maybe Micrium, or sometimes even, you know, a bare metal OS abstraction layer. So we can use our tooling to develop an application that runs in that environment. And what happens is, you know, when we exported our app and SCP'd it, we would generate a header file that gets linked into the FreeRTOS or the C project for the MCU. And, you know, it runs in its own task, so it's not an isolated process. And, you know, things like the input mapping, they run in their own task as well. But, you know, the MCU side of things is certainly a big part of our story and value offering, and we do that.
All right. Let's see, then we have, does Storyboard run on other Toradex non-Torizon systems?
Yes, it certainly does. So again, similar to when we spoke about the WinCE to Linux. So, you know, you can load Torizon. There's also a base Linux load without the Torizon environment offered from the Toradex Easy Installer. And we have runtime executables for each platform. So whether you're dropping WinCE, Linux, Torizon, or maybe even, you know, your own OS variant. You know, I know there's things like QNX or other operating systems that could be built to run on these environments as well. That's something we support. We do our best to be a hardware and software agnostic development platform.
Yeah. Okay, and I think it's the final question. You might have already kind of alluded to the answer to this before, but does Story need / require OpenGL?
No, it certainly doesn't. So we run across large varieties of hardware, as we sort of talked about earlier. So the MCUs, which are, you know, a couple hundred megahertz with you know, a megs of RAM, all the way up to the latest and greatest MPU application processors with GL support or Vulkan or other accelerators. So we scale the hardware space, and you know, we leverage what hardware is available to us to help provide a rich, interactive experience. And when that's not available, then we fall back to CPU and software-based rendering, which you know, we do a lot of optimization so that you can still get really, really rich interface platforms.
All right, then, if I'm not mistaken, I believe that was all the submitted questions. Thank you, Nick, for your help answering those questions. Yep. So if anybody has any questions that they come up with after the webinar is over, you can feel free to contact either Crank or Toradex, depending on who you think would be best to answer the question. Otherwise, I think we are good to go ahead and conclude this webinar. Thank you, everyone, for attending, and have a good weekend.